Hello, and welcome back to another philosophy reading. Previously, I recorded one of these videos in a library, and the library environment seemed to be very well liked, and so I do want to do that again. However, I have gained access for a short while to a very quiet house, so I will do another reading, this time a little quieter for those of you who like the silence, and I think we should continue with Simone de Beauvoir, The Ethics of Ambiguity. Turn to my notes section. Let's see, where did we leave off? We left off discussing how having a philosophy of ethics implies necessarily that mankind, or the being in general, is failing, or has failed, or has potential to fail at behaving in a correct way. In a morally correct manner. Well and good, but it is still necessary for the failure to be surmounted, and existentialist ontology does not allow this hope. I have known what ontology means, and I've already forgotten, so once again, it's time to look something up. Ontology, the branch of metaphysics dealing with the nature of being. It is the philosophical study of the nature of being, becoming, existence, or reality, as well as the basic categories of being and their relations. It studies the nature of existence or being as such. Easy enough. Existentialist ontology does not allow the hope of the failure to be surmounted. I assume because in existentialism there is essentially no failure because objectively there is no purpose. I'm not sure if that's what she means, but man's passion is useless. He has no means for becoming the thing, for becoming the being that he is not. That too is true. Is it? And it is also true that in being and nothingness, Sartre has insisted above all on the abortive aspect of the human adventure. Abortive aspect. Perhaps she means the things that the human adventure does not include, like purpose, for example. I don't know. I haven't read Being and Nothingness, and I only have a few references to it. Perhaps it's something that I should pick up for one of these videos. It is only in the last pages that he opens up the perspective for an ethics. However, if we reflect upon his descriptions of existence, we perceive that they are far from condemning man without recourse. The failure described in Being and Nothingness is definitive, but it is also ambiguous. Man, Sartre tells us, is a being who makes himself a lack of being in order that there might be being. That means, first of all, that his passion is not inflicted upon him from without. He chooses it. It is his very being, and as such, does not imply the idea of unhappiness. If this choice is considered as useless, it is because there exists no absolute value before the passion of man, outside of it, in relation to which one might distinguish the useless from the useful. The word useful has not yet received a meaning on the level of description where being and nothingness is situated. I think the idea being discussed here is that the passion she refers to is, I think, the intensity of feeling that humans experience when they want to be something other than they are, or they want to be, they want to have purpose, and they want to establish meaning and importance. She's claiming that we inflict that upon ourselves because there is no external value, there's no absolute objective value outside of the passion itself. So outside of the desire, there's no imperative. It's the desire that creates the imperative. The word useful has not yet received a meaning on the level of description where being and nothingness is situated. It can be defined only in the human world, established by man's projects and the ends he sets up. In the original helplessness from which man surges up, nothing is useful, nothing is useless. It must therefore be understood that the passion to which man has acquiesced finds no external justification, no outside appeal, no objective necessity permits of its being called useful. It has no reason to will itself. But this does not mean that it cannot justify itself, that it cannot give itself reasons for being that it does not yet have. And indeed, Sartre tells us that man makes himself this lack of being in order that there might be being. The term "in order that" clearly indicates an intentionality. It is not in vain that man nullifies being. Thanks to him, being is disclosed, and he desires this disclosure. So, under existentialism, there's no concept of objective purpose or imperative towards goodness or anything, of course. Productivity, creativity, love, goodwill, you know, all those things. There's no outside imperative, but that doesn't mean that these things can't justify themselves, that this desire, this imperative from within, it can essentially invent its own justification for existence. And this, she starts talking about disclosure here. Being is disclosed. So being, existence, is disclosed. Disclosure means to communicate, to reveal, to express something hidden. And so, thanks to the human's habit to nullify its own being, being is disclosed. And he desires this disclosure. I think that refers to something that a lot of us experience, where we want to be expressed into the world. We want our existence to be validated. We want our experience to be validated. We often want our internal experiences to become known and to be real. But I'm still... This concept she's got, that man nullifies his own being, I'm not clear on this yet. Maybe I missed something in the previous pages here. What does that mean? Let's see. She says we are at a distance from ourselves, which I guess because we observe ourselves, we have some distance in that not only experience our internal activity, but we also observe it. I don't know if that's what she's talking about. Perhaps she's talking about the self-destructive impulse that humans collectively impose on themselves. Self-destruction is a form of nullification for sure. And so we do things like we create the atomic bomb that is created only to destroy us. I don't know if that relates to it either. I feel like I'm missing something. So if you can see what it is I'm missing, go ahead and let me know in the comments. But in the meantime, I'll just continue with this ambiguity present in my understanding. That seems very appropriate. There is an original type of attachment to being, which is not the relationship wanting to be, but rather wanting to disclose being. So we experience a desire to be something, but then there's also the desire to disclose something that we are. Now here, there is not failure, but rather success. This end, which man proposes to himself by making himself lack of being, again, it's this nullification, is, in effect, realized by him. By uprooting himself from the world, man makes himself present to the world, and makes the world present to him. But what does that mean, to uproot oneself from the world? What does that mean in the context that she's talking about? This uprooting oneself, making oneself lack of being, nullification of being. I think these are all the same things, and I don't know what it is she's referring to. But again, I'm gonna continue. I should like to be the landscape which I am contemplating. I should like this sky, this quiet water, to think themselves within me, that it might be I whom they express in flesh and bone, and I remain at a distance. but it is also by this distance that the sky and the water exist before me. My contemplation is an excruciation, only because it is also a joy. I cannot appropriate the snowfield where I slide. It remains foreign, forbidden, but I take delight in this very effort toward an impossible possession. I experience it as a triumph, not as a defeat. Whenever the author references herself, it turns suddenly very poetic. And when she does it here, maybe this is what she's talking about. She says that she wants to be a part, essentially, of this sky, this quiet water. And she is at a distance from them. She is fundamentally separated from them. She knows herself to be a part of the world, but she does not experience herself as a part of the world. She does not experience herself as the sky, or experience herself as the water, or experience the water as a part of herself, or the sky as a part of herself. And so, because she's at this distance, she can see it, she can perceive beauty in it. And it is excruciating, but it is also a joy. And I love this little phrase, the snowfield where I slide. It's just the barest hint of a glimpse into the author's life. She goes sledding and brought that into her philosophy book, which is so far relatively impersonal, but we know that she goes sledding and she delights and anguishes in her separation from the rest of existence. That's what I'm seeing from that little segment there. This means that man, in his vain attempt to be God, makes himself exist as man. And if he is satisfied with this existence, he coincides exactly with himself. It is not granted him to exist without tending towards this being which he will never be. But it is possible for him to want this tension, even with the failure which it involves. So it is not granted to humans to exist without wanting to be God. And I may be wrong, but I think when she mentions God here, it's not necessarily a reference to a religious dogma. I think it could also very easily be interpreted and perhaps intended as an ideal state of consciousness, a state of perfection, possibly something that humans are evolving towards, but will possibly never reach. It is the, perhaps even the personification of the gulf between humans and the immense failure that they experience at being what they want to be, what their ideals are. Collectively, perhaps, but also maybe individually. Anyway, that's just a thought. And it is possible for humans to want the tension between being and failure to be what one wants to be. His being is lack of being. Lack of being another thing, the ideal. But this lack has a way of being which is precisely existence. In Hegelian terms, it might be said that we have here a negation of the negation by which the positive is reestablished. Sort of like a, you multiply two negatives and you get a positive. It's It's like that. Man makes himself a lack, but he can deny the lack as lack and affirm himself as a positive existence. He then assumes the failure, makes it part of himself. And this makes sense to me because it's only lack when humans define it as such. It's only lack from what we experience, which is crafted and cultivated by our own perceptions. We may redefine it, and we may examine it from other perspectives. And the condemned action, insofar as it is an effort to be, finds its validity insofar as it is a manifestation of existence. However, rather than being a Hegelian act of surpassing, it is a matter of a conversion. For in Hegel, the surpassed terms are preserved only as abstract moments, whereas we consider that existence still remains a negativity in the positive affirmation of itself. This is getting a little complicated. Let's see, the condemned action, I'm thinking something like an immoral action. The immoral action is a manifestation of existence. Hegelian act of surpassing. Let's see, she mentioned Hegel once before. I think she liked Hegelian philosophy because it didn't attempt to hide or diminish the undesirable or unresolvable aspects of human nature. Hegel was the one who talked about that moral consciousness can only exist if there is a disagreement between nature and morality. But it hasn't mentioned surpassing. This sort of thing definitely demonstrates how de Beauvoir was writing this as a response to the philosophical environment and the authors and writings there already, and it also demonstrates how ill-informed I am and how unread I am in this field. Hopefully we are discovering these things together. I'm going to try a search for the Hegelian act of surpassing. We'll see if I can find anything. Let's see. Hegelian surpassing. Let's see. Hegel and the Art of Negation. That sounds promising. Let's see. We see here the ambiguity, of the Hegelian notion of surpassing, which sometimes appears to be an upsurge from the inmost depths of the being considered, and at other times an external movement by which this being is involved. He counts the cost of his unfamiliarity with the science of logic. Might be a book. Not going to try to pronounce that. As surpassing is never external. It is always the purity of an inner movement, even if it is not always an inward movement. So, there's this German word that what's being referenced, so I'm going to look for that. It has several seemingly contradictory meanings, including to lift up, to abolish, cancel, or suspend, or to sublate. The term has also been defined as abolish, preserve, and transcend. So possibly they're referring to the transcendence of the self. Once again, I'm not entirely sure how to interpret it, but once again, I'm going to continue. Before I move on, I think I want to make a footnote of this surpassing. The chronological thing here. Whenever I run into things like this, I always kind of wonder. I experienced something some years ago that I would describe as the desolation and expansion of the self. But it's not an experience that I see written about very frequently. Yet I wonder if it's related to this. It seems to be a good word for it. I keep finding that there's all these words in German that are just full of meaning that English has no word for. It's kind of interesting. And it does not appear in its turn as the term of a further synthesis. The failure is not surpassed, but assumed. Existence asserts itself as an absolute, which must seek its justification within itself and not suppress itself, even though it may be lost by preserving itself. I'm not sure that makes sense. To attain his truth, man must not attempt to dispel the ambiguity of his being, but on the contrary, accept the task of realizing it. He rejoins himself only to the extent that he agrees to remain at a distance from himself. This conversion, perhaps the conversion of realizing one's ambiguity, is sharply distinguished from the Stoic conversion, in that it does not claim to oppose to the sensible universe a formal freedom, which is without content. Okay, Stoicism, again, I know a little bit about. I don't know if I know it in the same way the author knows it. So what I know about Stoicism is that it is a philosophy about accepting the world for what it is and
coming to peace with the inevitable and essentially submitting to reality. That's what I've read from Marcus Aurelius, who was an emperor in ancient Rome, and he was one of the first Stoics. The Stoic school of thought was one of those ancient ones that has a modernized version. It's probably called Neo-Stoicism or something like that. And here, de Beauvoir is saying that the Stoic conversion presents to the sensible universe a formal freedom, which is without content. I don't know what that means. I'm going to look up Stoicism and see if it gives us any clues. I mean, there's Stoicism, the emotional state, but that's not what we're going to look for. Stoic philosophy. It is an ancient Greek philosophy which teaches the development of, development of self-control and fortitude as a means of overcoming destructive emotions. I love Stoicism. I'm a big fan. Let's see, the Stoics teach that destructive emotions result from errors in judgment of the active relationship between cosmic determinism and human freedom. And it is virtuous to maintain a will that is in accord with nature. So that's the sort of thing that I mentioned earlier. They presented their philosophy as a way of life. The best indication of an individual's philosophy was not what a person said, but how that person behaved. To live a good life, one has to understand the rules of the natural order, since they taught that everything was rooted in nature. That's also something that I relate to. Let's look for something a little more specific. Let's try to find Stoic conversion. Stoic conversion consists of a return from those exterior events over which man has no control to interior things that depend on him, ultimately to reason. And will. From the instability of the tangible world, a circular movement carries man back to himself in a quest of harmony with the all under universal law. The Stoic seeks not to eliminate exterior reality through inaction, but to remain the self or to perfect the self through activity. The return to and knowledge of the self are central. And then there's French that I can't read. So there's a little bit of input about Stoic conversion. It talks about the return to the self and knowledge of the self through action, using alignment with nature as sort of a fundamental premise of what will bring virtue and peace. Yeah. Here they mention a social conversion, an upheaval in our worldview and system of values. Oh, no, it is for the individual. So the individual has an upheaval in worldview and system of values and turns away from the conventional view of the majority. This is a type of conversion. They were influenced by the cynics. Cynical is also an emotional, intellectual state, who would walk against the flow of crowds living a theater, or walk about backwards in public to illustrate their desire to swim against the current in life and go in the opposite direction from the majority of people. I could go on and on with this. I really like Stoicism. I think I'll continue from here, though. Again, with sort of an unclear impression as to what De Beauvoir is referring to when she talks about a formal freedom which is without content. To exist genuinely is not to deny the spontaneous movement of my transcendence, but only to refuse to lose myself in it. So her assertion seems to be that Stoicism denies the spontaneous movement of transcendence. I'm not sure she's correct, or I don't know who she's referring to, like which author she's referring to. And that's fine. I think I'm actually going to stop here and continue later. This reading of mine, it seems characterized by my own lack of understanding about her reference points. She's referring to other authors, other books. This book of hers is clearly meant to be read in the context of the philosophical literature and academic environment of the time. And I think that's why it's so difficult and unclear and ambiguous. So that's why this is a rather difficult reading. Not all philosophy books are like this, although some certainly are. It's my goal to talk about the ideas rather than the context, and so I hope that even with the difficulties, I hope I'm at least managing it somewhat. But I am enjoying reading this with you, and thank you so much for all your wonderful, sweet comments, and thought-provoking comments as well. I really, really enjoy discussing these things and hearing your input and seeing what other people have to say. You just make my day. It's really wonderful to hear your feedback, so thank you. And I will see you next time.